Welcome to the Reviews Without Remorse podcast with Joe and Dave. Be warned, the discussions in this podcast may contain detailed spoilers. For spoiler-free reviews of newly released films, be sure to check out our show on our YouTube channel. Enter at your own risk and enjoy the show.
Don't pander to us, kid. One tiny crack in the plot and our blood boils in 13 seconds. Lens flares might crop up and keep our eyes from focusing. And where you're sitting watching a terrible movie, see if you're still relaxed when your eyeballs are bleeding. Reviews Without Remorse is silly and funny, wrapped in critique and love. My name is David, and all I got left is my bones. And with me is the captain of the Enterprise, Joe.
What's up, partner?
This is episode 109. And in this show, we will discuss, it's a Marvel triple play. News one, James Gunn, in a shocking turn of events, has been confirmed to be the director of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3. News two, Marvel drops an Avengers Endgame trailer without warning. News, views three, Joe digested Captain Marvel and wants to add a little addendum to his review. And then, the first of the fan-named Kelvin trilogy of movies, Joe and I review the J.J. Abrams-directed Star Trek. How you doing, man?
I am good, my friend. How are you doing? There's a lot to discuss this week. I am dying to jump into this.
There is a lot, so let's just get right on it.
Let's go.
Set it yourself, bitch. We're the Guardians of the Galaxy.
Are you kidding me? and yet, Joe, I'm just, before we get to, if it's all right with you, before we get to your reaction, I just want to throw something out there for the audience to understand something. Okay, this news came out on Friday, March the 15th, relatively late in the day. It was confirmed all over the place, and it's interesting timing because basically all the hurdles for Disney acquiring Fox have been jumped. They're all done. All governments have approved and everything like that. Pieces that needed to be sold off have been sold off. All that other stuff has happened. The end date, the actual date of them completing the merger is March 20th, 5 days from the date of the announcement. I don't think that's a coincidence, Joe.
That is interesting. Let me ask you this. Is there something to be gained by the timing?
The thing is, yeah, there is, because the ball is rolling. It's not going to stop now. Nothing can stop this now.
Right.
Okay? The merger is happening. It's done. It's over with. You can't stop it.
Had this announcement come out earlier, would that have endangered the merger?
You don't know. The whole reason they jumped the gun so quickly is because they were in the middle of negotiations with Fox with the merger. So, at least, this is what I'm getting from it. And I gotta say, as far as business moves, it's kind of brilliant on Disney's part if that's the case, because this could literally be a case. We won't know for years, but this could literally be a case where they pull James Gunn in. And it's like, look, we've already had this discussion before. We're gonna save public face, and we're gonna have to let you be a whipping boy for a little while. But we promise you, this isn't the end of it. We're bringing you back. We just need this long enough for the merger to go through. And James, which would explain Gunn's contriteness and him being humbled and everything like that. And he probably even said, look, if you're going to do that to me, you got to at least let me be able to make other films. And they probably gave him the go-ahead, which is why they're willing to wait, which is what they said. They're like, we're willing to wait until he's done with his commitment to Suicide Squad 2.
Yeah, and wasn't there something recently that came out that you said there was a tweet or something where somebody said, James Gunn, we're not done yet or something or other?
Yeah, it was his brother, actually, that tweeted something.
Okay, all right.
So
that is interesting.
There was always been hope. This feels like a kind of a brilliant business move, if you think about it.
Yeah.
You know, you kowtow long enough to get the heat off of the bull crap when you're trying to do this big merger. And this is a huge merger. This may be the biggest media merger ever.
Mm-hmm.
All right, at least to date. So you don't want anything to possibly derail that. And something as dumb as James Gunn's old tweets definitely could be something to derail that. And I don't know, man. Kind of feels like the whole thing was just a sham.
Yeah, it does. It does feel a little bit like that, and it's. I mean, it's a good thing because I'm wildly excited to see him come back.
Agreed.
There is a part of me, and again, you know, I swear to God, sometimes I'm just like, come on, don't be the turd in the punch bowl again. Don't find the negative in everything that's positive. But I was really, really, really hoping that when this all happened, like when this the smoke settled. I thought maybe this is the end of that sort of that political game of digging up your old stuff to let's get this guy and get him fired from something or whatever. And when James Gunn came back, I was like, good. Let's just call that like okay. So somebody shot a shot across the bow. You know, look, we're not really gonna fire him, but we could have if we wanted to. So let's all just stop with that because we could do that all day long. And I really thought maybe that was. And then just last week, they did it again to somebody else. I'm like, all right, I guess that's never going to go away.
Who got hit last week?
There's somebody a guy named Tucker movies? Carlson.
Oh, I heard about that. Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
It's not going to go away.
Right. This kind of game nonsense is never going to go away. But it's like, it's just so petty and so pathetic. It's so irritating. So, again, just at the moment, I was kind of having a little hope. Oh, look at this James Gunn thing. It's going to go away. There was no hard feelings, whatever. Mm-hmm. I guess not. But anyway. But as far as James Gunn coming back, I am glad to see him back. I'm glad to see. I am very excited to see that at least a Guardians trilogy be complete because, again, the first two have been spectacular.
Yep. This is the first time in the Marvel Cinematic Universe that a trilogy is done with the same writer and director. And I'm so excited about that.
Yeah.
So, yes, welcome back, James Gunn. Sorry I had to go through all that. And, God, people, can we stop with the frickin' hit pieces on people? Yeah. It's ridiculous.
Seriously, enough is enough already. But welcome back, James Gunn.
God, seems like 1,000 years ago. I fought my way out of that cave. Became Iron Man. Realized I loved you. I know I said no more surprises, but I was really hoping to pull off one last one.
The world has changed. None of us can go back. All we can do is our best. And sometimes the best that we can do is to start over.
I am not watching a single another trailer for Avengers Endgame again. I'm done.
Go ahead.
I loved it, don't get me wrong. But, I mean, that last shot of them walking, all of them together, including Tony Stark, including Nebula, okay, fine, we knew that Tony wasn't going to die on the spaceship and stuff like that, but I just kind of feel like they're starting to be a little bit too much more of where the plot's going, and I really want to be surprised. Been waiting 10 years for this, I'd like to wait a little bit longer.
Well, it's funny you say that, because honestly, I had almost an opposite feeling.
Which was? Still not showing enough?
No. That they're... Put it this way, after the trailer for Infinity War, I kind of felt like, you know what? I don't think I'm ever going to fully trust a Marvel trailer again.
That's true.
Because, I mean, they clearly put the Hulk in that shot where he was fighting on Wakanda. And
right.
Then no Hulk. Okay? Little bait and switch. So I would not put it past anyone to put Tony Stark in the trailer at this scene, because again, that was a very, it was a little too telling, because the trailers up until now was all about, is Tony going to make it home or not? So the fact that they stuck him in here, it could have told us something, or it could have been a total bait and switch, because again, at some point, Robert Downey is going to exit the franchise,
right?
So I wouldn't necessarily put it past anybody to actually kill him off in this one, and that full-blown could have been just a bait and switch. I could be totally wrong. But again, after the last trailer, they've kind of got me to where I'm not going to take anything, you know, with more than a grain of salt.
Whatever it takes, right?
Pretty much. But that trailer did look pretty sweet, damn it.
There's just no way in hell. At this point, it could be Thor reading the gosh darn newspaper and yeah. being like, "We'll see you soon." But then it had that, you know, then it had that shot at the end to remind people, "Hey, look who else is going to be in the movie."
Mm.
Which kind of leads us to our next thing.
Yes, it does.
So, Joe, you've had a week to truly digest Captain Marvel.
Mm-hmm.
You've had your chance to see other reviews and stuff like that and get reminders of things that, you know, before we get started, I'm going to reiterate once again about the magic of movies, that sometimes a movie is magic. It's sometimes bait and switch. It's literally sometimes like a magician. He's trying to get your attention over here while his other hand is doing something down here so you don't actually see the magic. And I made an allusion to the fact during the review that it is possible that this movie just did that trick with us, which is why we're, you know, so positive about it. Joe, I think, may have seen the magician's other hand. So, Joe, let's hear how you're feeling.
Well, before I even get started, let me ask you, do you feel exactly the same way as you did last week, or did you have any more thoughts that you wanted to...
I would drop it an additional point, to be perfectly honest with you.
An entire point?
Just one point, yeah. Okay. I would have brought it down to a 7 instead of an 8. I kind of feel like weirdly, my knowledge of Carol and Ms. Marvel, eventually Captain Marvel and everything like that, I think that tainted my view of it a little bit.
Mm.
In retrospect, it is a very by-the-numbers origin story. It was fun. It was still fun. It was still exciting. I still liked some of the little twists and stuff like that. I'm still, like I said last week, I'm still not completely in agreement with the direction that they took the character, but I understood why they took it in that direction, and I truly hope that the, you know, assured but not smug Carol Danvers is coming, because a lot of her acting in the beginning of the movie was very smug. Mm. And we had even talked about at one point how, you know, as it goes, you know, when she meets the Rambeau family and everything like that, there's a humbling, and it's no more of smugness, it's more of a confidence. But it wasn't really portrayed well enough to truly translate into the character that I liked.
Mm.
And because of that, I've kind of backpedaled a little bit, and I've taken a point away. That's just me personally. Now, there looks like they're laying the groundwork for the actual Carol that I've been looking forward to for all these years from just the two scenes that I've seen so far of her in Endgame. So I'm hoping that the Russo brothers and Marcus and McFeely get her right. And I get the feeling since they've done everything else right so far, they're probably going to, but we'll see.
Mm.
But Joe, what about you?
Well, I'll say this. I also would have probably knocked it down a point, and I think a 7, after having a little time with it, I kind of feel like a 7 is a little more like it.
Yeah.
And I kind of, you know, when you and I had talked, when I first said to you, it was probably like 2 or 3 days later, I said, you know, I'm starting to have little second thoughts about in fact, I'll even go as far as to say there are moments in our review that I felt like I totally lost credibility, frankly. Not all of it. I mean, as I sort of re-listened to our episode and rewatched it on the YouTube, I felt like most of the things that I said in there, I more or less stand by. But the part that I really kind of felt like, you know what, I got it wrong, was the part about her character arc. And I said something about how there were no obstacles. I was afraid there weren't going to be any obstacles, but there were. That's the part I kind of feel like I wish I could take back. And honestly, you had asked me, you were like, you're like, all right, did you start watching other reviews? Is that why you're... No, well, but then, yes.
I wasn't accusing you of letting the other reviews influence you, Bub. I was just pointing out that sometimes when you watch all the reviews, I do the same thing. Yeah. And it suddenly dawns on me. It's like, oh, shoot, I hadn't considered that.
Right. Yeah. And there was a lot of that. But in all honesty, it really started to hit me just that night. Like, I literally saw the movie in the afternoon. You and I literally did our review less than an hour after I finished seeing it. And again, that was my first initial thoughts. But then when I got home, it was literally me and Mary were home that night, and we started talking about it some more. And I kind of said, like, you know, that I was sort of not sure about the character arc. And she was like, well, what is, you know, okay, tell me. And as soon as I started to compare it to the other Marvel films, that's when it really hit me over the head. I was like, wow, I really missed the mark there. Because when I started to compare it to the first Iron Man, the first Thor, where you had characters who were full-blown flawed characters who learned, you know, who went through trials and by the end were just completely humbled, you know, after going through an ordeal and essentially become different people. And I'm not saying that the whole character has to do a complete 180. I mean, Iron Man is still that cocky, snarky guy at the end of the movie, but with a tons more, having been humbled and having had to face, you know, impossible odds, being trapped in the cave and having to escape. I mean, these were rough times. And then coming to the realization that his own weapons were killing, you know, seeing the effects of what he'd been doing his whole life. You know, this was a life-altering journey. And when I looked at the Carol Danvers character, as I said, that's exactly what this thing was lacking. I kind of felt like there was none of that. And I kind of felt like I was sort of tricked or fell for it. You know, that immediate sense of like, well, look, there is her trials and tribulations. She kept falling down. Well, yeah, but then she kept getting back up. It's not like anything. I mean, and they literally show her as a kid falling down, getting up, falling down, getting up, falling down, getting up through the stages of her life. So, in essence, I felt like there was really nothing happening there in terms of character growth. I mean, again, she goes from cocksured in the beginning to cocksured in... It was almost like you can't go from smug and cocky in the beginning to smug and cocky, but now you can back it up more because you've got more powers than you had when you started. That's not much of a character arc. So that is where I feel like the movie really did drop the ball. I was hemming and hawing when we talked about Brie Larson, and I'm going to just come out and say that I think you could have easily cast a better actress in that part. I never got a sense that she was a confident character. I kind of feel like you needed somebody with like an Ellen Ripley level strength. You know, you needed like Sarah Connor levels of strength in that character. And I'm not getting it all at all from this actress. So, you know, that's kind of it. I kind of feel like the moral of the story is, I am going to say it, that I do think Marvel gave us our first Mary Sue. I do not think it's Mary Sue on the level of like Rey from Star Wars. I would call that like a 10. You know, that's a textbook example of what a Mary Sue is. This is more like a 2-3. You know, again, just they did. I believe they made that mistake where they were a little too unsure about running this character through the obstacle course that a Thor or an Iron Man would go through to change their characters so fundamentally. They were too nervous about doing that they gave us this where the character does not really have a lot to overcome. I mean, the moral of the story that I get is that she had to pluck the chip out of her neck to stop all those mean old other people from holding her back this whole time. And that's fine, but it's just not what I would consider a great, interesting character arc. It's a different kind of a character study, I suppose, but yeah. I feel like the movie was just got a little too shy to go for it.
I got to tell you the truth, my man. I think that when the Blu-ray comes out, we should do just a whole new segment of revisiting this. Because I feel like there's something here, and I think that the 5 or so minutes that we're spending right now isn't going to be enough to truly dig into it.
Yeah.
So when the Blu-ray comes out, I say we watch it again and we revisit. I'm actually going to go watch it tonight again with a bunch of people from my work.
Cool.
So, you know, we'll discuss.
And we will. And again, I... It's an enjoyable film. It's absolutely not anything I would say is not worth your time by any stretch. It's an enjoyable, good time. But as far as, you know, again, I still say a weak Marvel movie is 10 times better than your average other movie. So it's still a very good film. But on, as far as Marvel movies go, not quite there. But yes, I will absolutely revisit it.
I couldn't believe it when the bartender told me who you are.
Why are you talking to me, man?
Your father was captain of a starship for 12 minutes. He saved 800 lives. Including yours. I dare you to do better. Enlist in Starfleet.
The brash James T. Kirk tries to live up to his father's legacy, with Mr. Spock keeping him in check, as a vengeful Romulan from the future creates black holes to destroy the Federation one planet at a time. Written by Robert Orci and Alex Kurtzman, based on the television series created by Gene Roddenberry, directed by J.J. Abrams, Star Trek.
Interesting title now that I look back on it. Just Star Trek.
Yes. Yes. No name or title or anything like that. Just plain old Star Trek. Well, which makes sense because, in a way, this was a reboot, so they're just trying to say we're just starting fresh, cleaning the slate.
Yeah.
Let's do a little bit of disclosure for the audience, okay? How big of a fan of Star Trek is this guy right here, okay? I met Leonard Nimoy in 1975. I went to my first Star Trek convention in 1976. Okay? There's the smallest bit of my credentials. When we get to my Who Asked You, you're going to see the rest of them. just trust me on that.
Mm.
Now, there is a divide amongst Star Trek fans, at least when this first originally came out. There was a divide amongst Star Trek fans as to whether or not this was true Trek or not. And I'm here to tell you, as a Trek fan, it's not true Trek. It really is not true Trek. Okay? But where it succeeds, it gets the characters right, but it gets the story wrong, in my personal opinion. Ooh, I love the expression you have on your face right now. You're like,
right,
huh.
Yeah, you see me kind of going, oh, all right, let, all right. I'm already kind of going, ooh, do I agree with that? But go ahead.
This is going to be a very interesting episode, ladies and gentlemen, because there's going to be a lot of negativity from me, but I still like this as a movie. So what we have here is a clash that's happening within me. You have the film lover in me clashing with the Star Trek lover in me. And somewhere in between is the review that I'm trying to come up with here. I'm going to get very nerdy. I'm going to get very technical. I'm going to talk about things that the average film goer who doesn't know what the hell Star Trek is not going to give a flying flute about. But it means something to me.
Mm.
So, but on the other side of the coin, as much as I'm going to dig into it for all the things I feel like it got in reference to the Star Trek legacy wrong, I'll be the first to admit, this is a fun movie. This is an exciting movie. This is some great characterizations of these classic characters brought in them. It's basically take the characters from Star Trek, put them in Star Wars. That is the simplest shorthand I can give for this movie. Because this movie is like, you take the most action-packed Star Trek movie of like the past, of all of them, okay? Most would argue that the best action-packed one out of all of them would be Star Trek II: Wrath of Khan. Would you concur with that particular assessment?
I certainly would.
Okay. In the first 10 minutes of this movie, it blows the action from Wrath of Khan out the door. In the first 10 minutes. That entire opening sequence is some of the most outstanding action that I've seen in any Star Trek movie, in some sci-fi movies, and it still managed to have an emotional element with the birth of Jim Kirk at the beginning. And you got to credit Chris Hemsworth playing the part of George Kirk and Jennifer Morrison as his mom, and the insane musical score by Michael Giacchino's, you know, where they just dropped all the sound, they just had that violin and a little bit of piano playing as she's giving birth to Kirk. Holy smokes, you are not human. You're more than a Vulcan if you're not at least feeling a little bit weepy during that.
Completely agree.
So, yeah, this is not an easy movie for me in many respects, but I can still let go of that part of me enough to say that as a movie, it's good. It's fun. I feel it does its conventions in a fair way and doesn't go off the track too much. I think there's a little bit of editing problems here, there, and everywhere, but we're going to hopefully talk to that. But all told, it is an enjoyable movie. Still action-packed. Still so watchable. I mean, this is a 10-year-old movie now, and holy smokes, I couldn't keep my eyes off the screen.
Mm. Yeah, I am going to agree with you for the most part, wholeheartedly. I think this is a wild take on Star Trek. You know, I'd love to backtrack just a tiny bit and just talk about why exactly we have a Trek that looks the way it does and sort of the state of affairs of Star Trek right now.
Mm-hmm.
I have to credit, I just saw a video on YouTube recently. There's a guy named Robert Donovan, and it was basically...
Oh, I've heard of him.
He basically did a rant about the Orville. The Orville was sort of the punchline of his video, but he really kind of got into great detail about Les Moonves, CBS controlling Star Trek, but always feeling that it was sort of beneath them, that they really did not have any love for Star Trek, and mm-hmm. the split with Viacom, and by the way, Midnight's Edge has done extensive discussions on how the CBS, Viacom, how these splits and the rights to Star Trek is so carved up and all over the place that even if you want to make something Star Trek now, it's so incredibly hard because the rights to it are literally just carved up and scattered. So it is so difficult to even do anything Trek now. But again, it's amazing that instead of just allowing someone else or licensing out Star Trek for someone who cares about this property to do it with any kind of respect, they had fan films like Axanar. They had massive lawsuits about that. They made these draconian guidelines as far as fan films were concerned. It was just ridiculous. And now we've got Star Trek Discovery. And it's just kind of really bizarre. The moral of the story is that, like, oh, by the way, even with the... They went after Axanar and other Star Trek fan films for copyright infringement. Meanwhile, mm-hmm. they're being sued by the creator of a video game called Tardigrades, which
yep.
we've spoken about here, because uh-huh. Star Trek Discovery completely ripped it off. And I know that I should be a little more diplomatic as I say that, saying, well, depending on what you... No. If you see the side-by-side comparisons, I don't think anybody would disagree that they just blatantly ripped this thing off. So basically now, because CBS has just created such a dumpster fire of what was a wonderful franchise, and they've gone after their own fan base so much, you know, people who tried to do real Trek, well, they're busy doing this crap Star Trek Discovery, which nobody likes. They ended up creating a vacuum, and the Orville swooped right in and filled the vacuum. So now they literally created by trying so hard to go after anybody who would do a Star Trek-like film, they ended up alienating so many people and creating this empty space that a show like Orville was perfectly situated to come in and fill that gap. And now everyone loves the Orville and they hate Discovery. So I just thought that was kind of funny. And it also leads to why Star Trek had to sort of do this whole timeline thing. I didn't realize this when I first saw the movie. I just thought they wanted to sort of go back and tell new stories without having to address things that happened in the show per se. And I thought this was a way to do it. But it was actually more than that. Because of these lawsuits, they were actually forced to do something that was kind of Star Trek, but didn't exist in... And seriously, you can't even talk about Star Trek using words like canon and prime. Canon and prime are two different things now. It's so convoluted. It is such a mess. But anyway, one of the reasons why they had to sort of do this skewered universe, this off, you know, this alternate reality Star Trek, was because of the rights being all over the place, and it's literally just so complicated that I couldn't even explain it in 5 minutes.
You've been going for more than 5 minutes, and I'm still not sure where the hell you're going with all this.
Well, okay. So having said all that, I think what they ended up doing with this Kelvin timeline, at least in the film we're going to discuss today, I'm actually incredibly impressed with how they were actually able to pull it off, where they went back in time, changed the course of events, and can basically now say, from this point forward, everything we do now is our own thing. We can write stories how we please. We can have the characters go in different directions because nothing that happened in the Star Trek that you know from the original series, it doesn't exist. We're using the same characters and putting it in the same world, but we can do whatever we want within it. And I think that actually ends up somehow works out amazingly. Like how they were able to pull it off, it really still kind of boggles my mind. And I have to tell you, when I first saw the commercial for it, I still remember seeing the first trailers for this Star Trek, and I kind of went, oh no. I had serious, serious doubts. I mean, when they, they had some gratuitous shot of Uhura pulling off her top. And I kind of just went, I grabbed my head and just went, oh no, this ain't your granddaddy, Star Trek. So I was really kind of nervous, but I was incredibly pleasantly surprised by what they actually do.
I was kind of leery myself, to be perfectly honest with you, but I feel that while they didn't get a Star Trek-esque plot, first of all, the one thing about a Star Trek plot is there's a theme, okay? There is a general theme. The first Star Trek, the theme was change, growth, and evolution. Okay, the second Star Trek was about age and age catching up to you. Khan is literally the embodiment of Kirk's aging, catching up to him from all these years ago. You know, to him making allusions to being young and so on and so forth. The third is about friendship, because the crew sacrifice everything to try to help Spock. The fourth is environmentalism. The fifth, well, we don't talk about the fifth all that much, but the fifth, you know what? The fifth is the search for the spirit. Okay, so you can go with that. The sixth was about politics and learning to embrace your enemy as your friend in their time of need.
Mm-hmm.
Then you go into the Next Generation stuff, but see, here's the thing. The Next Generation was their own thing, so I don't hold them to the tenets of classic Trek. Isn't that kind of weird of me? Okay. but still, they tried their best to have, like, you know, themes going on with them and stuff like that, but none as clear as the original Star Trek. Each episode was a theme of itself. There was a moralistic tale to it. There was an angle about modern day. There is none of that in this movie. This is like an origin movie. This is Iron Man for Star Trek, if you want to put it in a certain way. This isn't about, there isn't about growth. This is about who these people are and how they all get together. Okay, and it's weird because if you don't have an understanding who these characters are, there's no really way to make the movie work. But one of the things that you have to appreciate is the fact that these characters are so iconic that even people that aren't Star Trek fans, they get the gist of who each of these characters are. And that's why their introductions, each of their introductions is so, short. You know, Kirk, Spock, and to a lesser extent McCoy all get, like, origin stories of sorts. But Scotty gets only, like, a really quick thing, and Sulu gets only a really quick thing, and Uhura, maybe a little more than a quick thing, but still only a quick thing, and even Chekhov, okay? But yet, even without that knowledge, it kind of still works. You know, I'm trying to look at this from somebody who's, like, never watched a Star Trek episode before.
Mm.
And I was watching specifically the characterizations, and one of the things I was telling myself as I was watching it is, like, now just imagine you don't know the history, okay? Think of this as a movie. You don't know the history of these characters. You're meeting them all for the first time. And I found that even then the characterizations were okay, but I feel like it's still embedded within you as a person that these characters are so iconic. They're like the sci-fi Batman and Superman and stuff like that, okay? Even without knowing their full story, you know the general gist of who they are. Uhura is communications. Chekhov is part of the tactical group. Sulu is the helmsman. Scotty's the engineer. Bones is the doctor. Spock is the science guy. Kirk is the captain. Okay, when you break it all down, that's pretty much what they are, and that's the iconicness of their characters. And I feel like I know I'm being like wishy-washy sounding, going a little back and forth there, and I really don't mean to be. But the thing is, I'm trying to balance my love of Star Trek with my, you know, my love of movies, and looking at it from that perspective, I still feel like it works. It's almost, in the case of like Spock, it was almost too much origin story. I kind of always liked the mystery of him, you know, coming to terms with his humanity versus his Vulcanism, yeah. Vulcanizing. I don't know. Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't know where I was going with that. I just wanted to talk. I don't think I had a point. I think I was just trying to point out that the characters I felt worked for what they were, even without having knowledge of who they were.
Yeah, I would. Well, yes and no. And I think it's interesting. I think that the characters, I didn't get a sense from this film that they were trying that hard to stick with the personalities of the characters that we knew. The one that sticks out the most to me would be like Uhura. I don't say that, I'm not saying that I mind it, and I'm not saying that I have a big problem with showing the younger versions of these characters. I mean, again, these are the Star Trek characters that we knew when they were cadets. I mean, they are, you know, college age, you know, they're children, more or less.
Right.
So I don't really have a problem with the liberties they took. I did feel, though, that there's some parts where I kind of feel like it does become a little more noticeable. Spock being one of them. I didn't really feel like they got a good handle on that character per se. I sort of agree with you that the shots of him as a child, there's a payoff for it. There's a reason why they go that far back, because he has the conversation with the father about why did you marry my mother? Okay, so it kind of worked, but seeing him scrapping it... I mean, seriously, we've seen Spock be emotional and fist fight twice in this film. And I kind of feel like that's... I'm not sure if that's the right way to go with him. And, of course, then you have Jim Kirk, who is supposed to be... You know, you had Jim Kirk from the show that we knew, who had a mother and a father who was in Starfleet, a father who was there for him growing up and who was inspiring to him to himself join Starfleet. Now we have troubled Kirk, who didn't have that father, now has like a no good stepfather and all that good stuff. Okay. I kind of felt like, even still though, I kind of was like, this kind of bad boy Kirk in this, I still go back to the shot of him with the car, taking the dad's car, which I didn't mind until he drives it off the cliff, jumping off at the last second, you know, that's a bit much for me. I even to this day I don't know if I'm buying that one.
I honestly didn't think you needed that type of introduction to Kirk.
Yeah,
I think that you could have easily, you know, gone from his birth to showing Spock being in school, and then showing like 20, you know, then showing like Spock growing up and deciding to not go to the Vulcan Academy and instead go to Earth. And you know what was great? One of the things I did enjoy, like early in the movie, it was like they trusted their audience. They didn't have to explain. They didn't have to sit there and explain that the reason why Spock was turning down the science position was because of the insult that he placed on his mom.
Mm.
They didn't have to explain that. The actor did it well enough. The scene was shot well enough that you understood. You didn't have to stop and have Sarek grab him and say, "Why did you do that?" Say, "Because they insulted my mother." You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
I appreciated that. But as the movie progressed, it was weird because then it suddenly became a situation of where they started, like, telling people. It's like, you know, the landing platform's out. We're not going to be able to beam Kirk and Scott and Spock out just now. They're on their own. It's like, they didn't need that. We knew that.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I would agree with that. There is a lot that... see, it's funny, too. And even to get way back to what you're saying earlier, you know, I think that Red Letter Media summed it up pretty great when they said that, you know, Star Trek movies, you know, some of them are classical music and some are rock and roll.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is a clear example. Like, Star Trek the Motion Picture, it's good in a classical music kind of sense. And then, right, yeah, the other ones that are, you know, like this one, which is clearly like rock and roll. So, yeah, you can have different kinds of Trek. And it's interesting because, and I don't know if I'm agreeing with you or disagreeing with you before, you were when I was making the face, because you were saying, like, the characters slash stories, like, they get it right in some ways, but different in other ways. I kind of felt like, I thought the story was just fine. The story works pretty well. The tone is what's really different. You could have had a story, even in the original series, about a, you know, time travel revenge for something that had happened over here and whatever. It could have happened a lot more in a kind of cerebral sort of a story, as opposed to, you know, like, again, Kirk wakes up, you know, with the hands blowing up and running down the hallway, screaming and yelling and yada, yada, and Romulans and this and that and the other thing. I mean, they purposely did this in an action-packed sort of a way.
Right.
So, again, I feel like that's where you kind of get the what's wildly different about the story. I mean, again, you've had Kirk make out with green chicks in the original show. Here, now you got him as in a college dorm making out with green chicks with another girl coming in and people in their underwear throwing things at each other. Like, you know, like it's like they take that and they sort of put it on steroids, you know? So, yeah.
Well, Gene Roddenberry would have appreciated that, by the way, but that's another story.
That's an interesting question. Like, would Gene Roddenberry have liked this incarnation of Star Trek?
No.
You don't think so?
No, he wouldn't have minded the shots of the sexy girls and stuff like that. Guy was a perv. Guy was a class A perv. I'll be the first one to say so. But no, he wouldn't have. He wouldn't have. Here's the weird thing about Roddenberry. He wouldn't have enjoyed it because, as far as he's concerned, it's missing the one element that he wanted to imbue in each episode, was that there was a theme. You know, the story that it was being told was peripheral to the theme that he was trying to get across. And the fact that there really was no main theme in this, other than we're getting the gang together, would have annoyed him.
Okay.
And he also wasn't a big fan of, you know, too militaristic things, which is kind of a weird thing for him to say, but he was weird like that. He also had a problem that if anything wasn't, like, approved by him.
Yeah.
So, who knows? He was a weird guy.
Yeah.
He was a control freak.
That is interesting, because I do feel like Star Trek as a whole, maybe not in the beginning, but, you know, when they show Starfleet Academy, and you sort of say, okay, well, what is that? Is it like a military academy? Is this like the West Point of Star Trek, or is this something else? It is sort of a weird amalgam, and I kind of feel like it's the later films that really kind of get, like the one after this, which I won't fast forward, but they really kind of get into Starfleet as military, which I think is a little off. That's when they really start to get off track. But here, I don't know. See, I'll even, this is going to be, it's going to be my day for weird analogies. I remember an interview with Bernie Taupin, who is the lyric writer for Elton John.
Oh, yes.
And they were talking about there was some tribute album that came out where a lot of different artists were doing their music, you know, and they sort of did an album about it. And he was being interviewed, and he was saying, like, and they asked him, like, do you like when they, and he said, yeah, he goes, I really wish I would hear more often that people would do our stuff. I wish, you know, people would do it more. And he'd say, you know, the thing I always hear is that, well, you can't outdo, you know, those songs were genius. You could never outdo them. He's like, yeah, but just do your own thing. He's like, I would love like a speed metal version of one of my songs. And I kind of feel like this Star Trek is almost like, you know, they're taking Star Trek and doing a speed metal version of Star Trek. You know, again, it's not, it is absolutely not just sort of taking that show and running with it and doing more Star Trek. It is kind of more tribute to Star Trek than anything else. It's kind of like we're making this new action science fiction movie in trying to keep the, is heart a little too generous, the heart of Star Trek? I mean, I do feel like in a lot of ways they are paying really great tribute to the original Star Trek. Mm-hmm. Some of it I think they do, you know, really spot on. I mean, and I kind of feel like they do their homework in a lot of places too. I mean, there's references all over to other things in the Star Wars universe that you kind of go, all right, all right.
You said it. You said it.
What?
Other things in the Star Wars universe. Yep. There it is.
Well, yeah, there is that. And by the way, you know, I didn't, you know, as I was rewatching it this morning, by the way, the part when Nero first comes over the comm to Pike, and he's like, "This is Christopher Pike. Who are you?" He's like, "Hello, Chris. I'm Nero."
Hi,
I had a flashback of the first of the opening of The Force Awakens. Like, what is it with J.J. Abrams and that kind of snarky teenage kind of banter? I don't quite get that. Like, the part when he goes, "Do you talk first? Do I talk first? How does this work here? I can't hear you through the helmet." You know, those lines from The Force Awakens. I was like, I all of a sudden I was like, oh my God, there's that again.
I don't know. It's that's the Abrams way.
Yeah.
As well as, you know, coming up with these incredible pieces of science with no explanation. Let's just call it red matter. Oh, it just makes black holes. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, there's that, right? But I mean, are we really going to ding this for that? Like, has Star Trek never had things like that before? That just this unexplained science?
You know what? A lot of time, yeah, they do get into technobabble a lot, as they call it. But at least they try to make it at least relatively close to science in some way, shape, or form. Like, people say, I've heard people make the argument, is red matter any different than the Genesis device? And I'm like, yes, actually, it is very different. Terraforming on a grand scale is not only theoretical, but it has been done in some laboratories where you can take and terraform. Hell, did you see the movie The Martian with Matt Damon?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Okay, so that's part in the movie where he's making the potatoes. All of that is science-based and is factual. And that is a lesser form of terraforming. So terraforming is not only theoretically possible, but has been proven on many occasions. So on a grander scale, okay, sure, they science fiction did, and it's like, oh, it's, you know, doing it on this giant scale, whatever, and that's fine. But the theory about it itself is sound. I don't know any science anywhere that talks about a piece of something that if you ignite it forms a black hole. That isn't a star.
I'm not disagreeing with the latter part of that. I kind of feel like that's a little stretching, that Genesis part. I mean, seriously, this is a show, and again, it's not a knock, but this is a show where they invented the transporter because it was too expensive to film shuttles going in and out of the craft every time they had to go down to the planet. They needed to do something quick.
Right.
And again, is that based on science? Well, I mean, again, it's based on theories of science. It's just as you could... I'm sure the red matter is meant to be something else that does form black holes. I don't know. I'm with you.
J.J. Abrams has this thing where, to him, science fiction means you can just make something up and go with it. And you know what? I'm fine with that. It's like lightsabers. Let's talk. If you think about the science of lightsabers, the idea that this laser just goes only grows yay high, exactly yay high, you know, is kind of, you know, then people will talk about, oh, it's actually a plasma sword and so on and so forth. Whatever, you know, you want to get into that, that's fine. But in that universe, it's acceptable because this is a hyper universe, so to speak. Star Trek has always tried its best to remain somewhat grounded, which is why episodes like Spock's brain is reviled to this very day. I'm getting into nitpicky territory here.
Well, it is Star Wars. It is Star Trek. I mean, we get the...
Again, you make the mistake. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, the reason why I've pointed this out now three times is because when this movie first came out, J.J. Abrams was going on interviews and basically saying that growing up, I wasn't a Star Trek fan. I was a Star Wars fan. And when you see this movie, it's like, well, that explains it. He basically Star Wars'd Star Trek.
Hmm.
You know, yeah. This was his resume to being able to do Force Awakens.
Yeah, I think it's just, more accurately, it's just a straight up action science fiction movie. Like, it is not meant to be.
Which is not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing.
Right. It's not in any way, shape, or form the cerebral Star Trek that we knew and loved as children. Frankly, it's not the cerebral Star Trek that Orville is doing better, which we've talked about at great length, I think. that to me is
nice
a little
callback.
More. Again, I still say that the Orville right now looks more like Star Trek than even the Kelvin Star Trek movies. They did take it and run in a wildly different direction. I do feel that it's done with a sense of respect. I really do feel that that's true. They did a modern action science fiction movie, a modern blockbuster film with the classic Star Trek in mind. And, you know, again, they'll have different levels of success later, which we'll get to. But, I mean, for the most part, I think I walked into this movie when it first came out really expecting something pretty dreadful. I was really nervous that this was going to be like the MTV Star Trek show. Honestly, I kind of felt like it not only did... Again, I'm judging it in two different ways. I'm saying it does pay enough respect to the original Star Trek as a source material. And I do still marvel that this film is cohesive story-wise. Because there was a lot to juggle. There was a lot of balls in the air. And for all its faults, they do sort of manage to keep it working. And I will go as far as to say this. I mean, there are times when they go way the hell out there and manage to bring it back in. Like, for example, when they shoot Kirk down to the snow, to the moon, I guess. It was a Vulcan moon, I suppose. And again, when you see the size and scope of this giant, he lands 20 feet away from where Spock is. For some reason, Spock is on that same moon, which also happens to be 20 feet away from a base on that planet, a Starfleet base, where Scotty also happens to be. So by a wild coincidence, you've got three of the original Star Trek core players within a very tight proximity of each other. But again, notwithstanding, it still manages to sort of pull it together before and close the story up in a way that I find to be satisfactory.
What is your name?
My name is James Tiberius Kirk.
You've always had a hard time finding your place in this world, haven't you? Never knowing your true worth. You can settle for a less than ordinary life. Or do you feel like you were meant for something better? Something special?
Well, I suppose the question is, how satisfactory? How satisfactory out of 10, my man?
It's funny. I'm still sort of going back and forth in my mind with this. And even as we're talking, I'm already having, like, Captain Marvel flashbacks. Am I going to be too generous here? But I do have to say that when I was watching it again... And again, I've seen this many times. I kind of almost felt like I didn't even have to watch it again, but I wanted it to be fresh when we talked about it. I'm going to give it a 9. And I really do think, like I said, they had a lot to juggle. And when you get into that behind-the-scenes stuff, you realize they were juggling even more than you see on screen. So the fact that they actually can pull it together and did a really nice ensemble piece where they give a lot of actors, a lot of players, their day in court. We explore different things that we've never really got into before. Even, by the way, it's so funny. I remember hearing from like uber Star Trek nerds who were all about like the books and stuff, like all these sort of subsequent books about Star Trek, about a romance between Spock and Uhura. And I swear this was a thing. So when I saw it on screen, I kind of went, oh yeah, that, I remember that. Not from anything I saw in the show, but things I'd sort of heard about peripherally. So there was something to that, I guess. And I decided to sort of bring that into this. I'm curious to know just how canonic, is that the right word? How canon that actually is, but whatever. I'm going to give this a 9. I think that it really is a great movie. It's a fun watch, and it doesn't betray. Like, when you walk away afterwards and you think about it, there's not a lot of loose ends. I mean, they keep it pretty tight, which is kind of impressive. So there you go. There's my 9.
So I spend a lot of this podcast basically bitching at this movie. And I apologize to the audience out there. Star Trek means a lot to me. It always has. It was my first introduction really into sci-fi. And I'll always have a soft spot for it in my heart because of that. And there are parts of me that will always be locked to the original canon as some people have taken to calling it. And that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. But I am also a film lover. And at some point, you need to look at something as a film as opposed to what has come before. I'm not a fan of remakes. We have discussed that hundreds and hundreds of times. Well, this isn't a remake. This is technically a sequel. It's a reboot of sorts, because it does still reference the original Spock. It brings in the original Spock, Leonard Nimoy, in one of his last roles. But my point is when you look at this as a movie, it works. It works very, very well. It is action-packed. It is tight. It is well-acted across the board. There isn't really a lot to actually complain about outside of my own little Trekisms. I have one thing, but, you know, that's unrelated to Trekism, an actual plot hole that is my Who Asked You, but we'll get to that in a minute. But it is still an enjoyable movie. This is like, I can't even tell you how many times I've watched this movie. And like Joe mentioned earlier, I felt like I didn't even need to watch it again because I've seen it so many times, but I still did to keep it fresh. And damn it if it's just not so much fun to watch. Enjoyable. You laugh. You still laugh at the funny little moments. You know, Scotty's introduction, his little interaction with his little whatever the hell that thing is supposed to be.
Yeah.
You know, just fun. You know, the one thing it got right from Trek, there's a couple of things it got right from Trek. It got a lot of the history right. It got a lot of the characterizations right. And it remembered to have fun, something that sometimes Trek sometimes forget that you have to do. You need to have fun, right? This is a wild situation. Kirk is a freaking cowboy, for God's sake. A cowboy isn't all dour and sad all the damn time.
Mm.
You know? And I feel Pine did a wonderful job of bringing that out. I gave this movie an 8. And I know, like I said, you know, you're probably a little surprised by that number. I bet you thought it was going to be a little bit lower. But no, the bottom line is as a movie, it works, and it works well. As a Star Trek translation, remember what I said about Batman? Tim Burton's Batman. As a Batman translation, it's eh. As a movie, it's damn good.
Mm.
And yeah, so there it is.
I'm not really surprised at all by your score. In fact, you let off saying, I did a lot of bitching in this. I didn't find that at all. I actually thought that the vibe I got from you all along was that you liked it very much, besides a little, you know, like you said, nitpicking with the Star Trek lore. No, I'm not surprised. I think that was, I could guess that's where you were headed.
Oh, jeez, I'm predictable.
Like I said, dude, we think alike too much in this damn podcast. We need something to argue about.
Well, maybe we can find out with Who Asked You?
My Who Asked You? I didn't have a whole lot that I really had a problem with. I think the only thing I will sort of go back to is that kind of the overload of the badass Kirk stuff. Little much. I kind of felt like they could have dialed that back. The scene in the car going over the cliff, I still look at that and kind of go, you have to be kidding with that, right? Like, I've seen troubled kids, and I don't know how, like, you I get what they're trying to do. They're saying this is a different Kirk. He's coming in to Starfleet via a different route as kind of a troubled youth, as opposed to someone who had maybe even a silver spoon, you could say, the original Kirk. I don't know. I mean, they were definitely playing with the idea that, you know, he didn't have the two-parent household that he had growing up, and the father, who was an officer in Starfleet, who was somebody to look up to. Without that, he was a troubled youth. And I don't mind that at all. But again, you can't go so far off the ranch that it doesn't make any sense now that he becomes eventually the same Kirk he was always meant to be. So that to me doesn't work. It's almost like you're pushing the level of believability now too far by taking this thing in such a strong direction. So that's mine. How about you, my friend?
Oh, I've got a couple. We're gonna put on this my Trek comm badge real quick for the first couple of ones, and then we're gonna get to the real one. First one, the triangular symbol that's on the chest on all Starfleet personnel, that insignia is individual to the ship you serve, not all of Starfleet. It was adapted for the fleet after the accomplishments of the original Enterprise timeline. Okay. So that whole symbol thing that they always use, that's a continuity error, because it's not supposed to be Starfleet wide. It was only supposed to be ship based. Now they could have easily fixed that by saying this was the Kelvin symbol and they adopted it in honor of the Kelvin and the sacrifice and so on and so forth. But you know, that's just me being a nerd.
Nerd!
Next, two men falling hundreds of meters per second to a planet. Let's transport them. I can do this. Got him. One woman already locked on, falling maybe like 10 or 15 feet. Oh, I lost her.
It's so funny you say that, because that I've seen the movie many times. That didn't really hit me until today, but go ahead.
Get him off the ship. I get it. Spock is struggling with his emotions. But man, not only was it a convenient get him off the ship, but it could have been a career-ending choice as well. That's not how you handle stuff like that in Starfleet. Which brings me to my next one, which is, what an astounding coincidence that not only did he throw him onto the planet that happens to have Spock on it, but he's in close proximity to him and the Starfleet base. Yay! That was nice of Nero to drop Spock off pretty close. And let's not even get into the fact that Spock could see the black hole sucking up Vulcan. Looked close enough like the black hole could have pulled that planet in too, don't you think?
Yeah, you would think so.
Okay, but this is the big one. When the spaceship, the Romulan spaceship, first appears at the beginning of the movie, the Kelvin is saying that there's like a lightning storm in space happening, and then the ship comes merging out of this giant quote-unquote lightning storm in space. Okay? It is Uhura that intercepts transmissions from a Klingon prison planet saying there's a lightning storm in space. Now, let's go past the part that it's glossing over, because there was supposed to be a whole subplot where Nero was captured by the Klingons and he had this big prison breakout when he knew it was time for Spock to arrive, whatever the case may be. But let's gloss over that fact that leaves nothing with us to know what he's been doing the past 25 years. But it now confuses the plot. What caused the lightning? Was it the giant black hole that the ships went through? Or is it the Romulan spaceship that causes the lightning storm in space? Because if Uhura heard them say about a lightning storm in space over Klingon territory, obviously that's supposed to mean the spaceship. But in the beginning of the movie, it showed that the spaceship hadn't even gotten in here yet, but they were still calling it a lightning storm in space. That's kind of a big error there that they needed to fix.
Huh. That is a good point, yeah. There are a lot of moments in this film where time seems to stand still, kind of like what you're saying about the two guys plummeting to the surface of the planet, and the one guy just keeps on going and you're right, like you said, here the lightning storm in space appears and he's running all around the ship on his way to the bridge talking to Uhura, and still they're not there yet. Yeah, that's a good point.
It was. All you had to do, just clarify exactly what causes the lightning storm in space. Is it something from the engines that that the ship does because of its drilling capacity? That's fine. That would have been great. But the way it opened, it made it seem like it was the black hole and not the spaceship that was causing the quote-unquote lightning storm in space.
Mm.
So that was very poor storytelling, and that needed to be fixed. That's my who asked you.
I agree.
How about for your consideration, my man?
For your consideration, I am going to go with the casting, because I sort of feel like this was one of those moments in time. I mean, again, this is not just, you know, who do you think would make a good Superman? Who do you think would make a good James Bond? Who do you think would make... This was an ensemble cast. So there were a ton of great opportunities and, you know, who would you get for this? Who should play that, etc.? And I think they sort of do a range of choices. Some they get because they are so accurate to the original. Some just happen to be, like, for example, an attractive African-American actress who's sort of coming up in the ranks. Somebody with an English/Scottish with a funny background. He's sort of up and coming. The guy from Harold and Kumar. You know what? He would make a good Sulu. You know, so
even though he's technically Korean,
right? I mean, he's Asian. Well, I'm not even sure what he was in the movie, in the show, actually. So I can't say.
He was supposed to be Japanese.
Is that right? Yeah. Okay. So that would make sense. But you know, again, and some they hired because they're spot on accuracy, I think. And you know, I think as far as that's concerned, oh my God, every time I watch Carl Urban doing McCoy, I'm just like, boy, is he a spot on young McCoy?
Yep.
So I really want to give it to the cast. I think Chris Pine makes a great William Shatner/Captain Kirk. Zachary Quinto, Leonard Nimoy is a tough... He's tough to try to just find a replacement for. You know, who could just walk into those shoes? Zachary Quinto, I think, does a pretty good job. Not perfect, but pretty damn good. But yeah, as far as for your consideration, the casting really impressed me.
That's a good one, man. I'm gonna give a little asterisk to Michael Giacchino's score.
Nice.
I felt like he did an amazing job with it. And by the time he actually got to do the Star Trek theme, I really felt like the movie and he had earned it.
Agreed.
So gonna give him that. And I'm gonna agree with you on all the actors, but I am definitely gonna center in on Carl Urban's Dr. McCoy. He just embodied DeForest Kelly in a way I didn't think was possible. He had subtle things. Like, subtle things that, like, new person wouldn't know, but an old fan immediately would notice. Mm. That he would just being able to do. Just little ways of looking at things. The way he would kind of look. Like, Kelly would do this thing every once in a while when somebody would do something, like, crazy, where he would kind of look. He would turn his head and look at you, and he would, like, look at you with one eye. And Urban just... got that down so well. And yet, while he was aping the performance, he still managed to put his own little spin on it and make it his own.
Agree.
And that's incredible. So I'm putting it out to Urban. He just, you know, everything about this movie, the special effects were outstanding, almost to the point that you took them for granted. But it is the performances, I think, that really make this, that elevate this movie above itself. Because everybody just was spot on, and Urban was just above and beyond, as far as I was concerned.
I agree.
He remains my favorite throughout the entire series.
Agreed. I really, again, that was a... He does a spot on impression, frankly. But again, not, like you said, not in the way that he can't stretch himself and do his own thing. He's great in the role, and he really does DeForest Kelly justice.
Yeah, agreed.
Oh my goodness.
But the fun has just begun, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, yes, the fun has just begun. Well, we got kind of a thing, because the movies, well, you know what? We're going to let next week's review get a better sense of what we're talking about, because next week we are doing the sequel, the still J.J. Abrams-directed sequel, Star Trek Into Darkness.
Lots of twists and turns and surprises in that one.
Really?
Or were there?
Or were there?
So that'll be another good one.
Yes, indeed. I'm looking forward to that. And then we'll tap off the series. So there it is, our review of Star Trek. And next week, we're into Darkness. Excellent show, my man.
As always, my friend. Spot on. And until next week, I will see you then. Thanks for listening to the Reviews Without Remorse podcast with Joe and Dave. Join us here every Thursday for a new episode. And be sure to check out the Reviews Without Remorse channel on YouTube for spoiler-free reviews of new releases. If you enjoyed this podcast, please consider becoming a patron. You can find our page on patreon.com. As little as $1 a month goes a long way. All clips in this podcast are used for commentary and critique, and is considered fair use. No copyright infringement is intended.
You have stage 3 space herpes, Jim. Have you been having sex with the aliens we've discovered?
There wasn't much sleeping going on. Wait, you said having sex. Too bad. That would have been funny.
Damn it, Jim. What about the Prime Directive?
Did I forget to tell you about the Prime Directive, big guy? Oh, wow. I'm getting some vibrant colors down there. Oh, that is ripe.
You've been spreading a virulent STD across the entire galaxy.
I have a lot to put right. Then again, we live in the 23rd century. Problem solved.
Damn it, Jim. You gotta notify every alien you slept with in the past 5 years.
Captain's log, Stardate, I'm not talking to Bones anymore. He's a real buzzkill. Relax, it's not like it's space AIDS. Scotty, here are the coordinates of every place my Wang made contact.
My mother's house?
I wouldn't kiss her on the mouth from now on. Or the butt. You wanna slide those knobs there, or you want me to keep going? So the chances are slim. But I'd get tested just to be safe.
I'm just a slave. The fact that you took the time to tell me really touches my heart.
Just like you touched mine.
Hey, I heard that. Chuck, this one's got a bug. Throw her in the incinerator.
So, remember that game I taught you? The naked game?
You never told me who won.
We both lost. Hello, the Gorn. I know we promised never to talk about our epic battle, and our hands clenched in anger found themselves intertwined in passion, but I might have given you herpes.
No shit.
Oh, really? Yeah.